I do want to talk to you both about England Germany before we wrap things up. But are Italy the most impressive team thus far, Mark, or is somebody else look more likely to win?
No, for me, for what they've got, yeah, absolutely. We know all about the French and the Belgians and all those kind of teams as well. But no, for me, yes is the answer to that.
Mm. What about you, David?
And Spinazzola is my favourite player of the tournament so far. Mm. Wonderful.
You're fine. Spinazzola, I mean, the two Italian fullbacks bombing on. It's not something we've seen from the English fullbacks thus far. So they play Germany on Tuesday. It's amazing looking, like the press coverage today. We do a Sunday paper review and you could still be here tomorrow reading all of the English-German preview pieces and the various angles across the paper. I mean, the Daily Mail is a two-page spread on the penalties, almost as if like this game is inevitably going to be settled by penalties. Don't worry about the 90 minutes and extra time. It's what are we going to do when we get to penalties? There's like a psychosis there of doom, I think, David, in some ways.
Psychosis is exactly the right word for the English attitude to the Germans. And it's tied up with, oh gosh, it's not just football history. It's England's sense of itself as the great power, and in a sense the history of English football those last 50 years has been the retreat from football empire, and we've been as neurotic about that as we were from in politics and geopolitics. So Brexit, you can see. Patterns of thought about, you know, Britain's place in the world and how we're supposed to be better than everybody else, but we find that we're not. You see it in politics, you see it in football, this neurosis that we always have to be the best team. We're always if we don't win the World Cup or a European Championship, it's somebody's fault. Whereas in fact, in reality, we're a mid-sized, you know, pretty decent footballing nation. That does quite well, you know, reaches quarterfinals, the occasional semi-final. So the English think about this game as they have all Germany-England games for many decades, kind of through a really distorted lens. Can you think through a lens? Anyway, see it through a lens.
So the interesting thing about England, or the striking thing, Mark, is, yeah. So look, I'm sure on the Italian version of Off the Ball, they're debating over whether Locatelli or Verratti should play, and I'm sure there's a quibble with the Dutch, and I'm sure on Portuguese radio they're talking about whether Fernandes should be in the side or not. Looking at the various English media here, the lack of any sense of England starting 11 or even the formation or how they should go about their business is just huge spectrum. There's no agreement on the team whatsoever. So for instance, Rooney here, who had been like pushing Grealish to the fore for the whole tournament, now says for the Germans they should really drop Grealish, start Rashford. And to be fair, I want to put his logic to you and see what you think. His team would be Walker, Stones and Maguire, Luke Shaw. He wants Declan Rice sitting with Phillips, and if he's fit, Henderson as a midfield three, and then he wants Rashford on one wing, Sterling on the other. His logic is Germany three at the back, they play a high line, their two fullbacks, their wingbacks will be pushed on very high. He said, when you get the ball eventually off Germany, and Germany have had 62% possession, 75% possession and 58% possession in their three games. He said, when you get the ball off Germany, Rooney says, they want you to give the ball to feet. And that's why he's saying the likes of Foden or Grealish, this one's not for you. So he said, don't give them what they want. As soon as you win the ball back, clip it down the channels, have Rashford on one, have Sterling on the other. That's where you're going to get at this German side. That was his plan. But genuinely, there's a different plan in every paper, on every page.
Yeah.
How do you see the hand that Gareth Southgate has to play here against Germany?
Well, I read that. That was in the Sunday Times, right? Yeah. The Grealish thing with Rooney. Listen, you know, when Grealish played the other night, he looked outstanding and made the goal, as everybody knows. And the thing about him is he gets the team up the pitch. That's one of the most important things with Grealish. And he would always get you a mass of fouls. He has this ability to attract opponents to tackle him, and he just kind of nicks the ball away for them and gets all these fouls. Look, you could pick so many different English teams. I think so far they've been perfunctory for me, to be honest with you. And I think, you know, the story has come out that Steve Holland and Gareth Southgate have looked at teams throughout the years in other competitions and the way that they played, and that, you know, that they wanted to be really, really cautious. Well, they've done that, and they've got through, and they've got the 7 points. They haven't conceded a goal as yet, but they haven't really played. They've kind of played in one... In 90 minutes, they kind of play in one half of the 90 minutes. We haven't seen, you know, an all-out display of... You watch England say, you know what, they were really, really good. We say they were very, very functional. I think Maguire will start. I don't think there's any doubt about that. He's obviously proven his return from injury, etc. I don't see the three midfield players playing together, because they're all very much of a oneness for me. And I know Phillips can, because he played well in the game against Croatia. But let's be fair with Croatia, that, you know, that they're an aging side. But Phillips generally isn't one that goes box to box. He actually stops the opposition central midfield players playing more than anything. And I just think it depends on the team that he plays. But I certainly would be playing Grealish, because I just think he's got it. I think he's just, you know, he's got outstanding ability. And the thing with England is that we had this big argument, big discussion after the second game about what's wrong with Harry Kane, you know, this, that and the other. Well, to be honest with you, he's hardly had any chances. And he hasn't really been kind of furnished, for want of a better description, with any balls in the box where he's got himself a chance, just on the odd occasion. And I think with Harry Kane, because you only have to watch them play with Son at Spurs, somebody up and around him, somebody that will run the other side of Harry Kane so he can maybe drop off, etc. And I think that's the biggest thing with England is now in this competition, they're going to have to be, or start to be, a bigger threat in front of the opposition goal, which they haven't so far.
I think that's the key point, isn't it, David, whether you talk about the lack of creativity with their midfield two or Harry Kane's form. Whatever the core issue is, the net result is they don't create many chances.
Well, I thought Mark touched on the word one twice there. I thought he was going to go on and say that they play in ones and twos and possibly threes. You've got lots of really talented... I can't remember too many generations of English players where there's such a lot of attacking talent, particularly creative midfield talent, but they're not used to playing together. It's not a team. There's no settled formation. There's no settled style. At the World Cup 3 years ago, it was much more settled, and you had these, for instance, these very elaborate choreographed corner and set-piece routines. They were all sort of doing the same thing. They all knew what they were supposed to be doing. It was more limited in a way, but it was very effective. And at the moment, it just seems like a bit of a mess. First 20 minutes against Croatia, they looked terrific. Potentially, you know, a really strong team. And then it just sort of disintegrated. And the conversation about Grealish or not Grealish, I remember this going back decades. You know, you'd have... There'd always be one sort of super talented player in the Football League or the Premier League. You know, it'd be, I don't know, Stan Bowles or Tony Curry or people like this in the 70s. And later it'd be Gascoigne or Hoddle. Or you say, well, you know, you've got to bring in the creative guy. Modern football is not about single creative guys. It's about teams having kind of well-rehearsed, well-practiced, well... They know how each other, the teammates know how each other thinks, and they know where to move and where to go. And you don't have that with England. You do have it with Germany, perhaps too much, because to some degree, you know, some of them are a bit old. Thomas Müller is now quite old.
You would think he is. He's only 31.
Is he really?
Yeah, it just feels like he's been around for 20 years.
The 1890s. How can this be? Well, anyway, but I think the point stands that the Germans have a settled team. You know, said people come in and go out, but you basically know how they're going to play, and they know how they're going to play, and they can extemporise from that. Mm. With England, it's a bit of a chaos at the moment, and I think Germany will win.
Do you? Yeah.
And I think the penalties conversation is, again, it's part of this backward looking kind of silliness. Really?
Yeah. The thing about Southgate, Mark, is the stakes here for him. I mean, if he makes a semi-final or a final, they don't have to win this thing for him to emerge okay. But if they bomb out here, then suddenly all the sheen of 2018 goes. Suddenly you can now interpret 2018 as, well, you lost to Belgium group stages, you lost to Croatia, you didn't really beat anyone, and now a couple of years on, there's been no progress. So actually, that's been a pretty terrible tenure. You know, suddenly everything he's done can be thrown out if they bomb out here against Germany. Huge stakes for him.
Yeah, although you know, if they do bomb out, I don't think he'll lose his job. I think the way the FA are at the moment, with not just the football, with everything surrounding football, etc., I think they very much think that he's the man to lead them forward. I mean, I was obviously working at the World Cup in Russia, and I just kept saying to people, they've not played anybody. They played the dog and duck in one of the games, I remember, in the league bases and everything. And, of course, it's a typically English thing where as soon as they win a big game, in inverted commas, they're going to actually rule the world at football. And as you rightly say, you know, Croatia beat them quite comfortably, I felt. The Belgians beat them easily. And, you know, they come home and they're all heroes. So... And in this group so far, they've just done enough. Now maybe just doing enough is part of a master plan where we might see a completely different England against the Germans. But I don't really see it. I think David's absolutely right. It's just you look at them and they don't look as a team. They've got very, very good players. They've got some technically gifted players as well. I mean, look at the two lads as well that play in Germany, and I think the whole of Germany, you know, who knows anything about football, is saying, why aren't these two lads playing? Because, you know, they've been really, really outstanding. But I just think it's this general thing between Holland and Southgate, which is this is the way we are going to get through, and this is the way we are going to win the competition. So I think Tuesday night, really, seriously, it's going to be massive. I mean, in terms of the TV over here and the audience, I think one of England's games so far has got 20 million. Well, I would think it'll be nearer 30. Probably half the country will be watching the game on Tuesday, and it will be fascinating. I'm not sure it will be outstanding football, but if they get through, wait till you start to read the papers after that one.
Well, I mean, if they get through, the whole thing opens up. I mean, they're on the right side of the draw, and then we're headed for the Dutch again, maybe in the semi-final. So to your eye then, Mark, it's pretty clear that this isn't, thus far in the group stages, this isn't Holland and Southgate realising that really pragmatism rules the day, and look, we're just going to grind it out in the group stages. We won't get any style points, but ultimately we'll therefore be well positioned for, you know, tight knockout football. Yeah. This is, it's not that in your view. This is a manager... They're scrambling a bit more than kind of quietly happy.
Yeah, and I think he feels that defensively against a really good side, I think they will have problems, and he's trying to instill to the players, you know, purely and simply by Rice and Phillips together, you know, against Croatia, because it was the first game, and because the tournament generally seems to be in England. I know we're playing in other venues, etc., but generally it seems to be in England. It certainly is for England to be there. And it's like the first game is always built up massively, and there's a massive expectation. And you know, they played well in that first half, yeah, probably for about half an hour against Croatia. And if you read all the stuff, you think, well, they're going to go and win it. They're going to walk over absolutely every team, but it's just not like that at all. And I just feel with them that he's not quite sure what his best team is, but he knows that they have to be so kind of tight at the back, organised, etc. And I think it's one of those where he'll just believe that whether it's Sterling, a Foden, a Kane or a Grealish, somebody will come up with a little bit of piece of magic in a game to actually go on for them to win it.
Yeah. God, for all the talent, it's a fairly reductive plan, isn't it? Let's try nick one.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and it'll be interesting. To, you know, if the Germans go in front on Tuesday, it will be very, very interesting to see what England do. And yeah, I would think that would tell us more about England than any other of the previous games so far.
And Mark, do you agree with David Winner, the Germans to win?
No, I have a feeling that England are going to beat them this time. And Don't really ask me why. It's probably something in my water. I just think England will beat them. I always feel with them, they have one outstanding performance in these competitions, and I just feel that might come on Tuesday night.
Okay.
The Germans are quite flaky. I mean, they were brilliant against Portugal, not so brilliant in the other game. They looked awful the other night when they nearly went out. Hungary very nearly beat them.
Yeah. Do you know what was interesting? Rooney in his column, it kind of jumped out to me. I thought the consensus after the French game was that they weren't great, the Germans. And Rooney here in the Sunday Times said their performance against the Portuguese, sure, they won 4-2, but he said the performances against the Portuguese and the French were among the best I've seen at Euro 2020. So he kind of liked the look of their performance against France.
I think we need a drug test for Wayne.
Yeah. That didn't jump out to me. I mean, they weren't awful against France, but the best one of the best performances, I hadn't quite seen that.
Well, I wouldn't go with that.
Yeah. Well, we'll see how flaky Germany go against England scrambling. Fellas, really enjoyed that chat. Thanks so much. David Winner, author of various titles, including Brilliant Orange, The Neurotic Genius of Dutch Football. I presume, David, you're tipping the Dutch to go through. Are you at five?
I think they'll go through tomorrow. It's tonight. It's
yes.
About half an hour.
Half an hour.
I think they'll win that, but I don't think they'll win the tournament.
Okay.
By the way, we haven't mentioned Denmark. They are also on this side of the draw, and they looked pretty good last night.
Well, that's true. That's probably a misstep on my part. Yeah, they're growing into this, to say the least, yeah. After a ridiculous beginning, or a surreal beginning. So 4-0, great goals. They'll be feeling good about life. Everybody's second favorite team. All that stuff.
Yeah, they're on the move.
Yeah. Well, thanks to you, David, and Mark Lawrenson, as ever, pleasure. Thanks so much.
Thank you.